The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your game. Tonight we're going to have a really cool time because our guest is Chris Pennock, and he's one of the people that I can always, from Facebook, I know you can always count on Chris to say what's on his mind. And so this is going to be a very cool show. I want to thank everybody who's listening on the players, and there's some people in the chat room, which is always cool, you know, to get some feedback and everything. And I invite everybody to check out our schedule page on GameCon Radio. There's a lot of really, really cool shows. There's all kinds of music played. Saturday nights, one of my favorite is Dr. Lester, who plays Shadowlands, and he plays vintage radio from, you know, back in the day when you actually sat there and made the story around what you were hearing. You know, it wasn't all visual. It's one of my favorite shows. And every Tuesday before we start out, DJ Smoochie starts out with her show, Homeroom, which is always great music. We have Doc Stan. We have Boot Camp. We have a lot of great shows. So check it out. It's on the schedule page. And I want to hope everybody had a good Labor Day and everything. We had vacation for 2 weeks, and I'm going to tell you, I'm never going to schedule 2 weeks vacation again, because in the 2 weeks, we managed to have our 13-year-old cat had to be put down, and she just went down like a ton of bricks. Turned out to be thyroid cancer that we didn't even know she had, because she was not sick at all. She just decided one day she wasn't going to get up and eat, and that was our little, uh-oh, something's wrong. And then we had my son Matthew got hurt. He did something to a disc in his back. And then to top it all off, the Friday before Labor Day, I live in Old Bridge, New Jersey. For anybody who doesn't watch the news, there was a shooting in a Pathmark in Old Bridge, New Jersey, an ex-Marine who was mustered out for psych problems, was working the nighttime shift, and he had a little altercation with one of the other workers, went back home, got his AK-47 and opened fire in the Pathmark, and Christina Legrudo, and another young man named Bean was, I'm hearing me, and he was shot. And Christine Labruto ended up being, she was one of my granddaughter's mentors when she got into the high school. And so, you know, it was really rough for Catherine. She, you know, before I could get to her room in the camper, the next thing we found out, you know, she came out, she was hysterical. Christina was a lovely, lovely young lady. And as it turned out, she normally didn't work the night shift. She usually worked day shift, but because she was going to start at Middlesex County College, she wanted to get a few more extra hours. And so when she did that, she switched with one of her friends, and unfortunately, she was the first one killed. And our sympathies go to both, all the families, even the Marine's family. This is a tragedy, and our heart goes out to all of them. And all I can tell people is just hug your kids, man. Hug your kids while you have them, because you know what? We never know what's coming around the corner, man. So, everybody, you know, I'm never taking 2 weeks vacation again as long as I live. Honest to God. There's a news article. I do a little crazy but news while you're all getting your popcorn and doing whatever it is you do to get ready to listen. News article is about a ghost group, some kind of ghost hunters from England, who decided to investigate an old case. And it's about the case with Ian Brady. It was the one where they killed a bunch of kids, him and this Myra Hindley and all. And they killed all these young kids, tortured them, and buried them out in the moors. Well, some ghost group decided they were going to go and investigate and try to find bodies. Please, people, don't do this stuff. Not unless a family comes to you and says, hey, please help us. We want answers. Stay out of people's privacy. Your job is to do whatever you do. Take care of your families, not destroy other families. And there's a lot of outrage, and this kind of thing is just totally uncalled for. They had no business getting involved in a cold case or an old case. And I really, I'm very upset, because the brother of one of the victims spoke out and said they were not asked to get involved in this. And this family has put it aside. This happened in 1965. Now this is all being dragged up again. Shame on that group. They're out of England. They should be ashamed of themselves. Nobody should bother with them again. With that, I have a couple of things. There's a lot of great stuff going on for the fall and Halloween. And I hope that people are going to get out there and do fun stuff. One of my favorite places is Lyndhurst Estate. Chris knows Lyndhurst Estate well. It's in Tarrytown, New York. They're going to have a lot of things going on in the fall, all kinds of Halloween events and everything. Also, the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery, which is like 3 miles from Lyndhurst, they're going to have all kinds of really cool tours and stuff. There's going to be a zombie fest in Atlantic City and Smithville. Very cool stuff going on. So please check out my site, which is asylumskate.com. And I'm going to be posting a lot of things up there. And if you have something going on in your area, please, by all means, post it on the site so people can enjoy Halloween. It's a fun time. People should be able to enjoy it. With that, I am going to bring our guest on. Chris Pennock is an actor. He is known for doing soap operas like Guiding Light, Dark Shadows, but he also starred in Frances, which is about an actress, a real life actress, and Frances Farmer. He's been in a lot of great films. He's an extraordinary actor and a very outspoken person when he wants to be. Chris, welcome to the lair.
Howdy. How are you?
Okay. Now it's your turn. You get to talk now. How you doing out there?
Well, I'm doing what a lot of us in the Los Angeles area do. I'm watching a police pursuit on television of a murderer who's stolen a white Honda. He's armed with an AK-47 and a handgun, and I'm watching this live, and it's very alarming. So if I suddenly start screaming, it's because I'm watching somebody get gunned down on live TV. This is L.A. for you. Actually, you probably have that out on the East Coast, too.
Actually, Oak Ridge is just this little sleepy town. We've never really had a lot of action out here. I mean, if you go up towards, and you were out here on the East Coast, so if you go up in Newark.
Born and bred.
Yeah, up in Newark, up in Union County, that kind of, you know, then you got to be careful. When I take my son into Orange, to the VA, This kid was in Iraq, and you know the story. He was blown up. It's like taking him into a demilitarized zone. He's waiting for somebody to pull out weapons. I mean, his knuckles go white when you drive up there. But down here, we don't have that kind of thing happening all the time. It's not OJ again, right?
Yeah, it's sort of like, it's not OJ, but OJ, it was sort of, that was a lot like this, because it was a white Bronco slowly going through the L.A. area, and you know OJ's there, and he's crouched down, and this is the end of his life, and yeah, it's unbelievable. But this thing, I don't know, this thing has just come to an end. I think they've surrounded it. Sometimes they have to watch out that there isn't actual bloodshed on live TV.
Right.
Because people get very upset.
Yeah. How did you get the acting bug?
I got the acting bug in school. I found I was really good at it, and some people started coming up to me after I'd do a play in eighth grade or something and said, "Pennock, you should do this. You should do this. I mean, really do this." And I said, "Hey, yeah, well, my parents want me to be a regular guy and go to college and become a businessman." But I failed horribly at going to college and becoming a businessman. So I think my parents were very happy I could do anything. So when I finally said, "Let me at it, let me go act, please."
Oh my God, honey,
they said, "Yes, we are with you, man, we are with you." So off I went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts, and I had a summer stock thing out in Wyoming, Jackson Hole, Wyoming, in melodrama, and then off to Shakespeare, and then I never looked back. It was great, but before that, life was pretty dicey.
Yeah, but let me ask you, because, you know, before you're going to go into that, you're saying, well, they want me to go into business, and this is hard, you know, and I'm thinking as children, because now I have a 16-year-old granddaughter, and all those lovely memories are coming back, you know, from my kids saying, "I hate school! I hate it! Why do I have to learn this?" But being an actor, to quote Jonathon Frid, It's an uncertain lifestyle, isn't it?
Oh, it's the worst. It is the worst. In terms of stability, you couldn't pick a worse thing. Yeah, it's the worst, but it's also most exciting and the thing that holds the most promise. And it's every day is an adventure.
It's the adrenaline rush, right?
Yeah, it's very, very risky. I highly recommend that nobody goes into acting out there in this radio or computerized listening area.
You can do anything else.
I mean, my daughter is a very talented singer and an actress, and she's in college, and she's finishing up. She's got 1 year to go, and she's thinking of critical psychology, and I'm encouraging her because, you know, you can always use the acting and the singing as a backup,
right?
But do something stable so you can make a living, so you don't have to worry, you know?
When I talk to my kids when they
terrifying.
Were young, I used to say, "You don't understand, Mick Jagger is an accountant. He's got a certificate. He can always go back and be somebody's accountant. That's why he's rich, guys. You know, you don't just give up your day job and starve to death for the rest of your life." But it is. It's got to be, I mean, from paycheck to paycheck. I mean, yeah, you have the Screen Actors Guild, and they have something set up, so if you're not employed for a while, you can get some kind of help, but it's got to be wicked on a family. I mean, if you land something, Dark Shadows had to be a blessing. You were on there like 167 episodes, right?
Oh, it was great, yeah, and I just met my first wife. We had met in a Broadway show, and it's like I wanted to get married, and I had my first steady job, and I was doing what I loved, and I was getting movies at the same time and commercials, and I thought, this is great. This will never end.
Yeah.
It ends.
Yeah, yeah. But
yes, it ends. But then it comes back, and then it ends again, and then it comes back, and then it ends
right,
again.
Right, because you were spotted in a play. A rather risque play for the time, right?
At the time, it was a shocker. It was called A Patriot for Me. It had been the big, scandalous, shocking play in London with Maximilian Schell, and it involved homosexuality in the Prussian army, and there was nudity on stage and drag queens, and it was very shocking. Of course, at the same time, when we opened it on Broadway, we were across the street from Hair, where everybody really was naked and smoking dope and shooting heroin and having revolutions. So we were actually a very conservative stage show, a patriot for me. But I did get my chance to be naked on stage and dress up in drag. It was the first of a number of drag appearances that I had that I found very liberating to dress up as a woman and leap around the stage and then rip off your clothes and run around naked. It's so liberating. I highly recommend that.
Well,
anywhere you are.
I've done my share of running around naked. But not on a stage, you know. Every now and again on this show, I think, oh my God, you know. I might as well be sitting here naked for the impact I'm making tonight. But yeah, it stretches you into boundaries where I'm sure you never ever thought you would go,
right? Definitely. What is that? Yeah, the right stuff that pushes the envelope.
Yeah. And then you were seen by one of the people directors of Dark Shadows, and then he brought you
in. Yeah, the casting directors.
Yeah.
Linda Otto and somebody else, and they thought I'd be really good for the show, so they had me in for Chris Bruneau's part, the owner of the antique shop.
Right.
And Dan Curtis said, no, 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 something about this guy. Save him for the thing in the box.
Yeah, the really
and
good
I,
movie.
And I wasn't happy. I don't want to be a thing in the box. I want to be a person.
Right.
Or at least I want to have lines. I don't want to be in a box. But it was a great part. It was Jeb Hawks.
Mm-hmm.
And he grew up from a little thing in the box to, the Leviathan. One of the most hated characters on Dark Shadows. I still get sneers, and I don't like them. I still get that at the festivals and the conventions. They don't like Jeb. And I don't blame them. I didn't like Jeb either. I had a lot of trouble with him at first. It was my first TV job, so my acting, I was struggling all the time trying to find that guy. Mm-hmm. I finally, sort of toward the end, I had an idea. He was sort of like Malcolm McDowell in A Clockwork Orange.
Right.
You know, a truly, a loathsome thug, but who has charm, who you love, who
and
you want to win.
Himself. He liked himself.
And to do that. Yeah, and they kept saying that to me. He has to be more likable, Chris. And I said, but he's a monster.
Right.
But he has to be more likable. I said, I don't know how to do that.
Yeah.
It took a while. Now I know how to do it. Gabriel was a likable monster.
Right. I have to tell you, as far as good-looking men, that show had the cream of the crop. You guys were all honey in that show.
I know. I mean, Selby, who has a face like that anymore?
Oh, my God.
And Gardner McKay were the best-looking men who ever graced a television screen. Unbelievable. Roger Davis, look at that face. Johnny Carlin.
Jerry Lacey.
Jerry Lacey.
Oh, my goodness. My daughter.
I could go on. And then the women. Then there were the women.
Well, let's stick to the men right now, because my daughter met Jerry this past summer at the Dark Shadows Festival. And she is in love. And if Jerry's wife kicks the bucket, my daughter is going to make a big fight for her, man.
That's so cute.
she says, oh, my God, that guy, and she's so funny. She says he stands up straight when he walks, and he wears a button-down shirt. Oh, my God.
He does. He didn't gain an ounce from when he was 21. I mean, he's wearing the suits that he had when he was 21.
Yeah, and he's...
How does he do it?
I don't know, because...
Steroids? I mean, how does he do that? That is disgusting.
But good for him. Yeah, but people who don't know Jerry Lacey, he also did the movie, played again, same with Woody Allen or something, where he did...
He was Bogey.
and he is an incredible Bogart impersonator. If you ever get a chance to look on YouTube for him, man, that's what you want to do. But he also has a CD out, and I'm going to plug it. Jerry Lacey, go to his Facebook or his homepage, because his CD is Halloween-typey stories, and it's $10, and the money goes towards animal charities, which you guys all know I'm a huge, you know, advocate. Help animals that are in these holding cells waiting for a forever home, as they call it. So, but the women, now let's get to the women. You're talking Catherine and Laura and, oh my God, Marie Wallace. She was a Ziegfeld typey girl. I mean, you're talking gorgeous women, and you guys got to make out with them all.
We sure did. That's one of the perks of being in show business. You get to sexually assault some of the most beautiful women in the world and get paid
Conrad.
For it, and you don't get in trouble, and, yeah. and you can walk away and say, sorry about that. No problem. It's great. Yeah. And I just did something with Catherine Lee Scott. We just did an audio drama, Sebastian Shaw Returns to Collingwood. It all takes place in the metal institution where Sebastian Shaw took Catherine Lee Scott. After it was right at the end of Dark Shadows, and off they go to.
Yeah.
Anyway, I just overact my ass off in this thing. It is wonderful. The guy at the end, I was screaming so loud. He said, "Half that, Chris. Half that. Just half that. Just
where can
take it down
that?
About a half, and it'll be just right." I said, "Okay. Yeah, yeah."
Where can they get that?
A lot of screaming. It's the Big Finish audio dramas.
Okay.
I'm not sure where you get them, but if you're on Facebook, there are all these ways of finding out. And, you know, I mean, I'm sure the fans know more than I do about how to get them.
We're going to be going to break in like 4 minutes. And the music, I always usually choose, you know, music that our, you know, guests really like, you know, because I want them comfortable and all. And two of the songs we're going to be playing tonight is The Doors, People Are Strange, and Neil Young, Old Man. But the first song we're going to be playing is The Guests Who Share the Land. And yes, it's a very old song, guys, from the 70s. But in light of today being 9/11, it has not slipped my mind. I think that we need to have a moment of silence as soon as I'm done speaking. Before we go to the commercial, we will have a moment of silence. But we are the United States of America. We are the world. This was not an attack on just Americans. There were people from every nation in the world in New York City that day, on those planes. There were Muslims, there were people of all faiths that were killed that day. There were people of all faiths that came and rallied and helped and dug through debris. And to say that this was an attack simply against America, it's not enough. This was an attack against all humanity, as far as I'm concerned. A bunch of bullies and thugs, whatever you want to call it, but this is something that we have to move past. Just like Pearl Harbor, we got to move past this, guys. And I'm happy that people are remembering it, but I want them to remember it for the right reasons. It's the one time that I can think of that the world united and said, hey, we had enough of this garbage. You know, we're not going to get picked off one by one anymore. And I really think that if we're going to remember this, we have to stop replaying it constantly on TV, because it's like opening a wound over and over and over, and there's no healing. I don't know who thinks that watching this go down every year on TV is going to heal anybody. I know people who were killed there. I know people who witnessed what happened. I've seen the after effects. I just don't see this going any further. I want them to stop playing this like a movie for the next 5 days. It started, I think, Friday. So in honor of those who died, in honor of all those who survived, in honor of all those who united, past all the politics, past all the garbage, the religion, past it all, I want to play Share the Land. But first, we're going to have 1 minute of silence. And when we come back, we're going to continue talking to Chris Pennock. And we'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio. God bless the United States of America. God bless people everywhere.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
To Mo Banshee's Lair Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We are rocking your world tonight with Chris Pennock. Again, I chose the guests who, an old song of theirs, Share the Land. I want the world to start healing. I want people to start healing, and maybe this is crazy of me, but I'm seeing a trend where people are becoming very antagonistic and I don't like that. I know we're not going to like everybody we ever meet in our lives, and I know we're not going to agree with everybody's philosophies, but you know what? We can agree to disagree and get on with our lives and not hurt each other. And if anything else, I hope that eventually 9/11 will become the standard for people getting together. Tonight, our guest is Chris Pennock. He's an incredible actor. And a big happy birthday to Tara, his daughter, which her birthday is today, which makes it one of the happiest days in Chris's life, right?
That's right. That's right. Yep. Just knowing that Tara was born today sort of healed me right through that whole nightmare.
Right.
Yeah, after it happened, there was the Tarrytown Dark Shadows Festival. It was 2 weeks after 9/11, and so we flew in right over the World Trade Center. We rented a car, drove to the pile, the smoking pile. I mean, it was just 2 weeks later, and I remember just being horrified. You could only get within a block of it, but just horrified. And the nightmares that night when we got back to Tarrytown, and just the breathing and the sinuses and everything just from that smoke, and
right.
We were only there for about 45 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, and then anyway, yeah, and my daughter was born on September 11th, but it's it's now her birthday. It's not that
right.
Horror anymore.
Right. That day, I'm just going to add this, my mother was alive, and she did not believe it when she saw it on TV. And she kept telling me on the phone, no, you know, that this isn't happening. It's got to be some kind of TV trick. And I drove her down to the shore. We live on the shore, but I took her to the water. And, of course, we could see everything going on, you know. And she was literally taken right down to her knees because she had always said to me, this country won't wake up until a bomb blows up in the middle of it. And
yeah,
here,
that's
here,
what it was.
And it was. It was. It, you know, so God bless mom's memory, but I will remember that day forever. But I think we need to get past it now. So you did, you got the interview for Dark Shadows. You're a handsome leading man. You're probably the most, besides Reverend Trask, one of the most hated men. See, I kind of missed a lot of the Leviathan thing because I was married and Vietnam was going on and I had a husband over there, you know, and you know, so I was starting to miss some of the episodes there. But you really got hate mail about this stuff?
Oh, yeah, I remember. Somebody cut my picture out of one of the fan magazines, drew pimples all over my face, mailed it to me saying, you are ugly. That was my first hate mail.
You know, I asked Jerry.
And I took it very personally. I wanted to find that person and track them down and put them in the hospital. I was very upset.
Oh my
How
God.
Dare you put pimples on me and say I'm ugly. Anyway, after about the 200th hate letter, I started getting desensitized, and it was okay, you know. And I got a lot, you know, I got a lot of good mail, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Ask your wife, she knows. You probably kept them all, and you throw darts at them, right? And this is for what you said. Jerry Lacey, I had asked him during the question and answer, because a lot of people were, like, you know, not asking questions. So I said, you know, you were the most hated man in the world. You know, you walled up, and I got to tell you something funny. Somebody asked him, but you walled up Barnabas. You know, did you get hate mail? And he says, I don't think so. If I did, they hid it, because I didn't get any. It would have bothered me. I guess Dan Curtis said, okay, let Chris get all the hate mail. As a matter of fact, give him Jerry's hate mail, too.
They like to keep me off balance and sort of, right. You know, insecure. They
yeah.
thought that was good for my acting. Have you read any of my comic books?
No, but I was going to ask you about them.
Because I've got a whole series of Fear and Loathing on Dark Shadows comic books that I created and drew myself and wrote and everything, and they'll tell you everything you ever wanted to know about Dark Shadows and what really happened and didn't happen. The drugs, the sex, the rock and roll, the scandal, the mental illness, everything. I mean, the stuff that was going on was much more dramatic than what was actually on television.
And when you talk to the others, it was, oh, we just met and we just worked, and once in a while we would have a drink after the show, you know. and oh, yeah, you know, we're talking about the 60s here, guys. Are you're telling me none of this? You know, everybody says it was very quiet. So the comic books are Fear and Loathing on Dark Shadows, and you do all the artwork, right?
Yeah. I began life as an artist. I won a big art contest when I was 5 years old. I won the Milton Bradley Crayon Art Competition.
Uh-huh.
I was the kindergartner. I still have the plaque.
Wow.
I won $500 savings bond, and I beat out every young artist in the whole country.
Wow.
And I had just seen Red River, the movie with John Wayne, and I was mm-hmm. inspired by John Wayne killing this Indian, stabbing it in the river. That was somehow the one that I remembered. That was
mm-hmm.
the scene. So I drew it, thinking, this is what they want. They want America the Beautiful. So they said, oh, that looks like a cowboy digging, a man digging. That's perfect for America the Beautiful. And I'm saying, no, it's a cowboy killing an Indian. No, this looks like a man digging, Chris. You won the contest.
Wow.
So I sort of felt like they didn't get it. They
right.
didn't get it.
But that's
anyway,
not child's
I'm,
play. That's a serious competition.
It was very serious, and I was extremely talented, and I sort of let the talent go. I still draw, but I need work on the draftsmanship. I need work on my cross-cutting and my blacking and all the stuff that you have to do as a really good illustrator. And I also like to rush through things. I did Fear and Loathing on Facebook in 5 days because I got the idea. I thought, okay, there's a Dark Shadows Festival coming up in 5 days, and I need a comic book to sell, and I'll do Fear and Loathing on Facebook. Perfect. And I did. I did the whole thing in 5 days. It was exhausting. But I'm a fast drawer. I'm a fast creator. I like to do it
mm-hmm.
fast.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you.
You can get them on my ChristopherPennock.com. That's how you get the comic books.
There you go. That's where we can find them. So go to ChristopherPennock.com.
My old friend Ed Lambezi created my website.
Very cool.
Ed, if you're out there, God bless you, and Jesus loves you.
I know. My site, I looked at the kids and went, does anybody know how to build one of these things? Because I didn't even own a computer until like 12 years ago, and I'm like, a website? You guys want me to start a website? You know?
No, I'll tell you. I know.
It's not easy stuff. Let me ask you, actors who really inspired you to get into acting, was there somebody that you said, I want to be like him?
Yeah, the first one was Jimmy Dean.
Wow.
In East of Eden, Rebel Without a Cause and Giant. And the other one was Marlon Brando in Streetcar Named Desire. Mm-hmm. Those two guys just took acting to a very realistic, incredible level that was very moving and touching. And I wanted to do that. I wanted to be that. And then some of the British actors, like Richard Burton and Peter O'Toole, later on inspired me. And and right now I'm actually acting one of them. I'm acting Sir Donald Wolfett in a play called The Dresser, and it's going to be at the Actors Studio coming up in about a month. And it's this incredible masterpiece of a play about Shakespearean actors in the 40s in London, while the Nazis are raining bombs down on London. They still did shows.
Right.
They did Shakespeare, and it went on no matter what. It was incredible. And the character I'm playing is a womanizer, and he's having a nervous breakdown. He has to do King Lear. So I get to do everything on stage that an actor ever dreams of.
Wow.
And it's all in this 1-2-hour masterpiece that I'm getting to do. And it was my dream part, my dream play, and they're producing it for me at the Actors Studio. So I'm a happy man.
The Actors Studio
hope come
in
to it.
LA.
October 19th at the Actors Studio in Hollywood. And hopefully this will have a life beyond this. Maybe take it to New York. Maybe take it to London. Maybe take it to Australia. Anyway, I'm dreaming.
Well, if you go to New York with it, you better send me an invite so I know you're there.
You got it, honey. You got it.
I mean it. I really mean
absolutely.
It because
you got
I absolutely
it.
Love it. I love Broadway. I do have to say something. My kiddies knew that we are a very artistic family, and that I've always tried to show them the arts, you know. So they're very musically inclined. They love, my daughter loved theater and everything. So for my birthday, after my daughter started working, she decided she was going to treat me to a play in New York. And you know, she had the limo pick us up, and we went to Sardi's and ate, and everything was wonderful. And then we went to the play, and it was Miss Saigon. And I kind of went, oh, wow. I didn't have to eat enough of this back in 1969. Now I got to actually relive it again. And I'm like, I want to take that kid and I want to choke him to death for knocking up the Vietnamese kid. But we did well, you know, but it's my funny story about the kids taking me. I thought you would have liked it. I said I liked when the I liked the special effects when the copter went down. That was cool. So The Dresser at the Actors
Studio. Yeah, there's an Actors Studio, the one that started it all. In New York on West 48th Street, I think. And then there's the West Coast Actors Studio, which is where we're going to be doing this.
Who inspires you now? When you look at actors now, and a lot of actors, a lot of people don't realize that while they're not making movies, they go back to what is called legitimate theater, you know, and they try to bone up there. But a lot of people don't, you know, realize that. Any young actors, any actors out there now that you go, wow, he's good?
Oh, man, there are so many wonderful actors now. Well, Meryl Streep always blows my mind.
Right.
Jessica Lange, who I actually work with, keeps getting better and better. She keeps taking chances.
She's in that American
Gothic. She keeps growing. It's wonderful.
She's awesome.
Daniel Day-Lewis blows my mind. Ed Harris blows my mind. Philip Seymour Hoffman, he did Death of a Salesman on Broadway. should have got the Tony. He blows my mind. They're a phenomenal actors. It's great. It's exciting. And they're doing incredible work. And I hope they continue acting on the stage, because that's where it's at. That's where it's at for me. You know, I mean, filmmaking is very tedious. It's very technical. It's hard. Acting on stage is the most brilliant thing ever invented.
Yeah.
To do a play for 2 or 3 hours on stage is just
Let me
heaven.
Ask you, have you
Bliss.
Watched American Gothic yet with Jessica Lange on AMC?
No.
She's the mother of a ghost in there. Her son.
Oh.
Oh, American Horror Story. That's it. American Horror Story. Thank you, Tech. And she's the mother protecting her kid, which you find out halfway through this. The first season is actually a kid that pulled a school shooting and ended up getting killed. She's amazing in it. She's amazing in it. She looks like she's, 40 years old, 38 years old in this thing. She's awesome.
Yay. Fantastic.
She
is awesome.
I like that they're bringing out a lot of older actresses and actors now. It's not all bubblegum and pimples.
No, I know. Because we, as we age, if we stay with it, we get so much better.
Right.
I mean, the roles I'm getting now are incredible. When I finally surrendered to being 60, and then now I'm almost 70, when I finally said, okay, I'll play the old guys. All right, you got a part in a nursing home. All right, I'll do it. I'll do it. Okay. But then all these wonderful roles have started coming to me, and it's extraordinary. It's wonderful.
Well, look at Ernest Borgnine. The last 20 years or so, he's been in, like, different TV series, and he's always been the old crotchety old guy that, is always getting in trouble and stuff. He made that transition seamlessly. And he was so awesome in it. And there are so many great actors out there that I think to myself, why didn't they bring this guy out? Why didn't they bring that guy out? Because, and maybe this is prejudice of me, I don't know, but a lot of the older actors, it seemed when you saw them, well, even yourself, I'm going to go with you, and you're not an old actor, but when you see you in a movie, you're a different character. I don't look at you and think, oh, well, there he is in Francis. You're different every time I see you.
That's my job. Yeah.
A lot of young actors, every time you see them, it's, oh, yeah, well, that's the same character. It's basically the makeup that makes them different. And that's something that kind of has been depressing with movies now.
Yeah. I mean, that's the joy of I come out of the actor's studio, where it has, I mean, 4 out of 5 members of the actor's studio are giant stars,
right.
Are phenomenally talented, and that we are trained to find our characters and live the characters. I've been living this guy on the dresser for the last 2 years, and I love it. It's driving my family insane, and my dog is frightened of me. But they know it's my life. You live these parts. You go deeper and deeper and deeper. One guy I met at the Mill Valley Film Festival was Forrest Whitaker. He had just done the movie, The Last King of Scotland. He played Idi Amin. He got the Oscar that year. And the guy is phenomenal. He transforms himself. He has emotional depths that hardly anybody does anymore. He completely becomes Idi Amin, and I love that, and it inspires me, and that's what I want to do.
Ben Kingsley.
I want to keep on doing it.
Ben Kingsley. He's another
Ben,
actor.
Yeah.
He
there you go. Oh, yeah.
He can do anything. And in Shutter Island, when you get all the way to the end of that, and you finally figure out what's going on, and he says, you blew up my car. I really liked that car. The character completely was different from that very spooky, creepy, what the heck is this guy's problem, to all of a sudden, he became a human being. I really liked that car. I mean, he's another phenomenal actor. And I have to say, when it comes to young actors, Ben Affleck is really good. I like him.
He's getting better and better. And then
he's
a good director. Holy shit, he's a great director.
Yeah, get a hold of him, because there's this book I know called Priceless. I had the Robert Wickman on, and it's about a jewel thief. Get him to do a movie about that and put you in there, man. That'd be a great movie for you guys to work on.
That's a deal.
Talking about Francis with Jessica Lange, how did you get the part?
Oh, that was great. I think I read the L.A. Times, and I read that they were going to make a movie of Francis. And there's something about, I don't know, Jessica Lange and some of the people they were thinking of, and Sam Shepard, I think, was in, and Kim Stanley. And I thought, I've got to get in this. I can play her husband. And sure enough, the husband came up, and it was Leif Erikson. But they changed his name because I think he was still alive, and he wasn't, you know, very well presented in the movie. So I came in, I read for him, they screen tested me, and it was the best screen test anybody had ever seen at Warner Brothers. They had never seen a screen test this good. They actually told me that. So, of course, you know, every time I had a screen test after that, I'd blow it because I had that pressure. But I've got the screen test, and I am pretty good. And the secret to it was, she says, we're breaking up, right, and we're having this huge fight. And she says, aren't you overdoing it a bit? And that sort of gave me license to go all the way with my rage and tear up the room and everything, and I did. And that was the secret. And actually, that's the secret to The Dresser, too. Mm-hmm. Somebody said after seeing me do The Dresser, you know, Chris, you are actually more dramatic than your character. And I thought, thank you.
Don't encourage me.
So I got that part. I remember, God, I was up in Idlewild with my dog Hefty, and I got the call. And I went down, I found a bar, and I started drinking shots and tequila and beer, and got drunk and ran around the forest yelling and screaming and tearing off my clothes. And just because I got this great movie, and I was going to be a star. Mm-hmm. And it was a star-like part until they cut four of the big scenes when the movie finally came out. So the whole arc of my character was a little bit shortened. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it could have been an Oscar winner, you know,
or
I don't know. I forgot who got it that year, but it could have been, or a Golden Globe or something. I could have really had a great career, but they cut four of the scenes. And that's just what happens. You never know. You never know. Or you could have been totally cut out of the whole movie.
Right.
But was left was good. You know, it was good.
Right. It's a good dramatic movie. Please, just for people, because we have a lot of young listeners, tell them who Frances Farmer was.
She was an actress. She was a big movie star in Hollywood. She was gorgeous, blonde, and she was very radical politically. She was a communist. She was very radical. She was part of the group theater, which actually turned into the Actors Studio. And she was hanging out with Clifford Odets, who was very radical, a radical playwright at the time. Mm-hmm. And she was finally, I think she suffered from bipolar disorder. Mm-hmm. Other people say it's schizophrenia, but it's definitely bipolar, because she is way up and way down and extremely emotional and just doing these crazy, crazy things and then withdrawing into herself. So I think it was a bipolar thing, and they locked her up in a mental institution, Camarillo State Hospital, for years, and gave her a lobotomy, and she finally came out of that with a lobotomy, had a radio show, and then died of lung cancer. The horror of Frances is the treatment that they give you when you're a little off, when you're a little demented, when you have problems, and you're captured and crushed and destroyed, and it's a very disturbing movie, but everybody should see it.
Yeah, she had no problem with saying, no, you don't like me, you don't really want me here, you know. She knew she was a lot of people's meal ticket. She absolutely understood that, and she rebelled a lot when people tried to control her or use her. And the movie is called Frances, and I encourage everybody to get it, to watch it, because there are some phenomenal roles in there. Christopher.
Kim Stanley.
Oh, my God. You were good in it. Jessica Lange.
Sam Shepard.
Yep. They are all, and nobody overshadowed anybody, and that's when a movie works. When everybody does their job and nobody's...
Yeah, they're the best actors in Hollywood and
nobody's,
New York.
Everybody, it's not a pissing contest. They do their job. But the name of the movie is Francis, and it's an incredible movie. I encourage people to really go back and look. Some of the older movies are great. You did basic training was very different for you. Well, maybe
basic
not.
Basic training
you were
was
used
so
to
funny. Major Magnum.
Yes.
Yeah, Major Magnum was a transvestite in the Army, and he liked to dress up as a woman. He also was an exhibitionist, and there's a scene in there where I run around with a G-string and dance. Oh, I mean, I choreographed the dance myself.
Oh, you did that?
Yeah, I choreographed that. Yeah, that's how I dance.
Okay. Well,
I mean, that's how I dance today. If I didn't have a hip replacement, I'd still be dancing like that today.
Yeah.
And, and then he also, somebody goes down on him like during a speech, you know, and then everything happens. It was a hysterical movie. I hope everybody looks for Basic Training. It's Pennock at his comedic best.
Yeah. Let me ask you, were there any movies that you almost got, you went, son of a gun, you know, and I'm sure that's not what
you... Oh, Right Stuff.
The Right Stuff.
I almost had The Right Stuff. John Glenn. Uh-huh. And they screen tested me a couple of times for it. And I think I sort of blew the screen test. I sort of froze up, as I was wont to do in those days. And... Ed Harris came in the next day. He sort of froze up. He wasn't happy with his audition either for John Glenn. Mm-hmm. But as he walked out, he was so upset he put his fist through the wall of the casting office. And they loved that. They said, this guy is great. He puts his fist through the wall. That's who we want. That's John Glenn.
That's John Glenn, yeah.
Yeah, so, he got the part. And actually, he was totally perfect for it. I would have loved to have played Jaeger, but Sam Shepard had that. But I was very close to getting The Right Stuff, and that would have been a nice follow-up to Francis.
Mm-hmm.
But no, it was Basic Training, which wasn't really a huge hit, but sure was fun to do, run around naked.
What is the Lily Rock Lifetime Achievement Award? You are a recipient of it.
Ah, yes. That was the Idlewild Film Festival, which is the town that I live in, coincidentally. It's a independent film festival, and they gave me a Lifetime Achievement Award. And I was not real happy with that, because that's usually at the end of a career, and I thought they should retitle it a Mid-Career Achievement Award.
Right.
So they said, yeah, then we'll do that. So anyway, yeah, that was a goodie. Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. It's right on my mantelpiece of my fireplace. There it is, Christopher Pennock. Lifetime Achievement Award, and then there's Christopher Pennock, favorite non-human on Dark Shadows, that's next to it. Then there's Chris Pennock, best actor in Dark Shadows for his performances, Jeb Hawks, Dr. Longworth, John Yeager, Gabriel Collins. Oh, then there's my Francis plaque. And then that's it. Got to get some more.
You're going to get some more. We have to go to break, and... I think the next song that we're doing is Hang On, Tonight's Show. What is the next song we're doing? People Are Strange by the Doors. We're going to be right back. Our guest tonight is Christopher Pennock, actor, and you direct too a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so when we come back, we'll talk about the difference between being an actor and directing. They're not the same game. We'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio, and we're rocking your world.
To that home out on the range, they got a lot of
Game Con Radio, we rock your game.
Emerson.
Got questions.
Who are we?
Where do we come from?
Are we alone in the universe?
Is there life after death?
Where can I take a class and really learn about demonology?
Now, get the answers. For a decade, The American Institute of Metaphysics has offered the ultimate in courses designed to serve as the foundation in your search for life's questions. The courses cover a variety of subject areas and consist of wide-ranging alternative sciences, theories, and philosophies. Each course comes complete with textbooks, work materials, and instructions. The courses allow you the freedom to pursue your own areas of interest according to your schedule. Whether it's UFOs, life after death, demonology, cryptozoology, and more, you've got questions. We've got answers. Visit www.instituteofmetaphysics.com or call 877-623-3241 and start your search now.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Air on Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. Tonight our guest is Christopher Pennock. He's an actor, director, he's an artist. He has a magazine, Fear and Loathing, on Dark Shadows, which you can find on his site, Christopher Pennock Online. It's his official site, ChristopherPennock.com. You're also a director, Christopher. How does that change between being an actor?
Well, the main thing, the first thing I directed was a production of Our Town, and it was the 8th grade elementary school here in Idlewild. And I remember seeing Our Town at the Topanga Canyon Theater in L.A., and I was so moved by it. I thought it was a profound, incredible play.
I love it.
And to do this with 8th graders was incredible. You know, the little kid that played the stage manager that learned all his lines. You know, the couple that had actually were boyfriend and girlfriend, but then had broken up. Mm-hmm. But then they had to be together again because they were playing the young guy and the girl, you know, and the girl that died. Right. I mean, it was so wonderful. And I was teaching them method acting, how to find those personal connections and use everything in your real life in your acting part, which is how we work at the Actors Studio. And I was doing that with 8th graders. It was a masterpiece. After that, I could just, you know, retire from life. I felt like I had done everything. Right. Our Town, 8th grade, it was a mind blower. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience.
If anybody has never read the play or My Town, it is a wonderful story about a small town, Americana, I think like the 1930s or something like that is usually when it's done now. And you have one person who comes out and he actually has a personal relationship with the audience. He is telling you what's going on. He's describing the relationships in the play between the other characters, but he's the one that's introducing you to everybody, and it ends up in the cemetery at the end where all the, for lack of a better explanation, spirits are waiting as more of their family and loved ones come, and the young woman has to learn that it's done. Now she has to give up the emotion and the attachment to her life. It's a wonderful, wonderful play. It's incredible. That's amazing. And for 8th graders to pull it off. Wow.
Yeah, and they pulled it off. And I think 2 years later they did it on Broadway with Paul Newman playing the stage manager. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was a hit. Now they just did it again in Santa Monica with Helen Hunt.
Wow.
The Academy Award winning playing the stage manager. So it'll keep going forever.
Oh, yeah. It's one of those timeless ones. You know, it's one of those that I just saw, what was it, last fall or last spring, Angela Lansbury in Blythe Spirit on Broadway.
There's another one, yeah.
There's another one that I don't care how many times they bring it back. I love it. It's timeless. You know, it's just time. And it, of course, it's not like the movie, which a lot of people felt, Rex Harrison, the movie, it was sacrilege because it was a play and you didn't have to use imagination because obviously they could make her a ghost. She could disappear and stuff. On stage, you have to use your imagination, which my imagination is a whole lot better than most writers. So
I believe it.
I mean, I can make up some really scary stuff in my head. So, get your kids to see plays, man. They open the world. They open the world.
Yeah.
Get them to read the books before they see the movies and stuff. It's the way to go. When I asked Marie Wallace, because Jonathon Frid had directed her in The Lion in Winter, what it was like.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yes, yes.
I would love to do The Lion in Winter with Marie Wallace. Yeah, I think we'd be incredible.
Wow. I says, what was it like for him? She says he was very professional, but there weren't any tantrums or anything like that, you know? It's got to be hard when an actor makes that. You know, now you're not an actor being yelled at by a director. Now you're the director yelling at the people you used to sit there and say, what a jerk. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it hard to make that transition?
Yeah, it was interesting because we now have a director for The Dresser, but for a year and a half, as we were doing big scenes from it at the Actors Studio, we had no director, but I was trying to direct it just by feeding the actors with mm-hmm. my acting. Mm-hmm. I could manipulate them into, usually, hopefully, with just my acting. I could sort of steer them around, you know, with my acting, because I worked on this part so long and so hard that I could. So it was sort of like directing, but not directing. Just by insinuating and just bringing them into situations and emotional areas that they've never been before, so it was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I have had major problems with authority figures. I just don't do well with people who are an authority. I never have.
No kidding.
I think
really?
A lot of us actors have that same issue, especially mm-hmm. people in the actor studio. We are undirectable. Mm-hmm. You know, if a guy starts directing you, you have a tantrum. You know, how dare you direct me? I'm doing it. I don't want to be directed. It's horrible. And I think it might have gotten in the way of having a really good career, because people didn't want to work with me because I would have these big tantrums. You know, it was an issue. I definitely had issues with authority. Then when I started directing myself, it turned it all around, and I could have a relationship with the person in authority, and he wouldn't be above me. There wouldn't be a hierarchy. We would have a relationship, a director and artist, and that made all the difference.
Mm-hmm.
But it was truly a psychological problem, I think, because my dad was very sort of dominating and a bully at times, so I would have that problem, you know, that issue
mm-hmm.
with anybody who reminded me of my father. I mean, I was in a movie called California Suite. I played a cop, and I had a couple of scenes with Richard Pryor and Bill Cosby.
Right.
And the director, his name was Herb Ross, who has since, Herb Ross has passed away, but he was also a choreographer and a bully. And he bullied Walter Matthau through this whole movie. And I didn't know that. I thought it was just me. Anyway, he started bullying me on the set. And he said something like, why don't you raise your voice a little bit? You only work once a year, in front of the whole cast.
Yeah.
And I took him aside, knowing that I will probably never work for him again, but I had to do this. And I took him aside and said, do not ever talk to me that way again. You do not ever talk to actors that way. That is completely unnecessary. You are an asshole and a bully, and you will never do that to me again.
Right.
And he said, okay, that really wasn't for you, Chris. That was for that actress you were working with, but I hear you. I hear you, Chris. Or something like that. Anyway, he did cut one of my scenes, the little bastard.
mm-hmm.
But it was such a good feeling. I mean, I never did work for Herb Ross again mm-hmm. because he died. But no, he had a couple of movies after that. But it felt so good to stand up to the bully. It is so great.
Yeah, it is.
Wonderful.
So, preferences, theater, movie, TV?
Theater. Love theater. That's my major preference. And then film, because you have time. You can work on a couple of pages a day. The hardest thing is are soap operas. I mean, that's truly slave labor, because you're doing 50, 60 pages a day. You're memorizing, and you are barely hanging on for dear life.
Mm-hmm.
That's the hardest job an actor can have. Although, you know, it was the main thing that I did for many years. But episodic TV is tough if you're the guest star, because they bring you in and you're thrown into this ensemble, and mm-hmm. you have to come up with a big thing, and it's usually working very fast.
Right.
So I love theater, I love film, TV, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But theater is blissful, and it's a blissful experience.
Right. Dark Shadows, it seems to me like it was a great training field for
Yeah, it was
all
like a
you.
Repertory theater.
It was. It was very
you
much
died,
like what,
you
what's
were
his
brought
name
back
did.
As another character, you know,
yeah.
and then another
Orson
one, and
Welles.
Another, and another. I had eight characters. You know, we
yeah.
all did.
It was like Orson Welles. He had his
star yeah.
players, and they
yeah.
came back for each movie, you know?
Yeah.
You
God bless Dan Curtis. Yeah, he was amazing.
Yeah, all from a dream. All from a dream.
Yeah, from a dream, a vision. Yeah, yes,
yeah.
You dreamed it. Yeah.
So let's talk about some of the characters you interacted with. Jonathon Frid a lot. How was he to work with?
He was so funny, because he and I both had problems with lines,
mm-hmm.
and he really had a problem with lines.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, there is a famous story about Jonathon Frid, and this will be the first time anybody's ever heard this story. He was at Stratford, Connecticut, in the Stratford Shakespeare Festival. This was in the 50s. And he was playing a messenger. And he came on stage, and he said the messenger's speech very loudly, very proudly. And then at the end realized that it was from another play. It wasn't the right messenger speech. And he said the line, and then realized it and said, "Oh, shit!" and walked off stage. And people on stage were laughing. People in the audience were laughing. And Jonathon was hiding in his dressing room. Oh, shit.
Was he a bit of a perfectionist?
That was the beginning of his problem with lines, I guess.
Yeah.
Because when he was on Dark Shadows, he and I were both the masters of the teleprompter. We really had that down to the point where we could just place that teleprompter right over the other actor's shoulder and just read it right off. And I love telephone calls, because you could just be on the telephone and just be looking right at that teleprompter. And you never had to memorize that. Because, you know, these were tough, I don't know, Gordon Russell scripts were great. You could memorize those. Sam Hall's not so great, because humans don't talk that way.
Right.
Yeah. Some writers have, you know, you can memorize some. It's impossible. You need the teleprompter. So he and I were always going up on our lines, and, you know, it was a total panic situation. It was like being on live TV. So our heart rates were the fastest of anyone. We were always in terror, so we became very good friends, bonding in terror.
Yeah, that's what...
Just to live through the day, just to survive, and, you know. Yeah, I mean, there were times when I hoped I'd have a heart attack, so I wouldn't have to do the scene. I could just go to the hospital, but I'd survive. But I just wouldn't have to do the scene. I mean, it was truly terrifying.
Right. Laura Parker and Catherine both said there were times when the lines were changed right up until takeoff time.
Yeah.
When you were, and they're handing you different papers and now expecting you to remember them. And David
yeah.
Ford was really tough with the lines. And actually, him being the storyline where he went blind worked out really well, because then he could unabashedly just stare at the prompter and
right.
and read all his lines, you know?
Right, right. And you know what? The best character, if you were going to come on Dark Shadows, if you started as a ghost, it was wonderful, because you could get used to TV and everything, and you wouldn't have any lines, because you were just a ghost. And then maybe you had lines later, and your character would develop from that ghost. But being a ghost was a wonderful way to start. Jeb Hawks was a Leviathan. He had a lot of lines, so I was just thrown into the bathwater. Boing!
We have a question from the chat room, and they're asking, was there any ad-libbing done? on Dark Shadows?
I tried to ad-lib as much as I could. So there was. I was always... I mean, I could never really memorize it word for word. Most people can, most actors can, but I just never could. So, yes, most of my things were ad-libbed. Mm-hmm. Most of my lines were not as written. They were paraphrased.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that, did that follow you through your career? Did anybody say, this guy couldn't remember his lines?
Yeah, there were writers on General Hospital that dreaded my presence that day, you know, that just, oh, no, it's Pennock. He won't read my lines right, you know. Yeah, I was legendary. I'm making a special effort to get every line right for the dresser because they're beautiful lines. They're exquisite. They're like Shakespeare. Some of them are actually Shakespeare. So, you know, if they're really good lines, you know, God. Yeah, on Francis, I remember ad-libbing and improvising the whole scene with Jessica Lange. And everybody was going, whoa, wait a minute, this isn't the script. Okay, they want to do it this way, all right. But I started, you know, just, it was like Tootsie. I'm coming up with lines that were not in the script. And they did cut that scene. I wonder if that's why they did. Darn. I might have blown that. Yeah.
Yeah, one of the guests in the chat room is saying, but everybody flubbed their lines. But that's one of the things that makes the 66 series of Dark Shadows a cult classic, was because it was taped from, it wasn't exactly live, but it was
called taped. Live on tape, and they would threaten us with, you know, we can't ever do this again. You know, and actually they did with some of Jonathon's things, but, you know, they said it would cost too much. You know, it would be $20,000 a second or something, which is nothing now. But, yeah, in those days, they threatened us that you cannot do these scenes again.
We have another question from Bumpkin in the chat. What about the new movie, Posey?
Oh, yeah, that I just heard on Facebook tonight from the producer that it's completed, it's edited, and it's great, and the producer said, and Chris, you're great in it, and it's going to go off to the Sundance Film Festival, the Telluride Film Festival, all kinds of film festivals. There's probably going to be a screening in the next couple of weeks, so hopefully I'll be able to see that before it goes to the film festival. But I hear good things about it, so I'm real happy. That was one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life. I had to do a Bollywood dance for 14 hours straight. And it was choreographed, and I couldn't follow the choreography, so I had to make up my own dance. That's what the director finally said, Chris, don't do the choreography. It's okay. It's all right. Do your dance.
Your happy
Chris's dance. And it will be great. Just do your dance. And I said, all right, and I did, and it worked out.
I got a lot of laughs. Sundance is, they're saying in the chat, Sundance is a big deal. All the festivals are big. Sundance is run by Robert Redford.
Yeah, that's the best one.
Yeah.
Sundance,
what is
Toronto,
Posey about?
Which is happening right now. Yeah.
What's Posey about?
Posey is about Alzheimer's. It's about a woman whose mother is starting to lose it and starting to get dementia, and she has to put her in a rest home. And it's a terrible thing, and we've been dealing with Lynn's parents, because one of them, her husband is starting to lose it a bit, and that we're thinking about maybe they should be in a home or something, because they're losing it, they're forgetting everything.
Yeah,
so anyway, that's what the movie's about,
the
and
problem,
it's about that
yeah.
horrible moment where you have to. Mom, you got to go to this place because I can't take care of you, and you're losing it, you know, and it's Alzheimer's. So it's painful, but it's wonderful because Sally Kirkland plays the mother, and she is so brilliant. She got an Oscar nomination and a Golden Globe for a movie called Anna, and she's amazing. She's from the Actors Studio, and her performance is so incredible that you will laugh and weep, and she has a fantasy, a dream, that she's in a Bollywood musical with all the people from the rest home. And she gets a little crush on this guy who's playing the piano. That's me. And then suddenly I come out of this Bollywood dance number. and we have this romance on screen, and we're dancing to this incredible Indian music. And I won't say any more because I don't mm-hmm. I don't want to give it away, but it's supposed to be pretty incredible.
It is. My daughter has a friend, and her mother has just been put in a nursing home because of it. And it's a very sad disease because it does steal their identity. But there are some funny things that kind of help it along the way. And one of them is she went to put her wash away. The daughter was putting the wash away that she bought for her mother, and she found this picture of an African-American model in her drawer. And of course this woman is Swedish. She was a blonde Swedish woman, you know. And so the daughter says, "Mom, who is this?" She says, "That's my boyfriend. Isn't he a hunk?" And so then the next day, evidently, she had made friends with one of the men there. And evidently, the man propositioned her. And at the time, it sounded good. But then all of a sudden, when he came to deliver the goods, she had totally forgotten who he was, what he was doing there.
What are you doing? Who are you?
She was beating the daylights out of this guy. You have to kind of find the giggles where you can with that, but it sounds like a wonderful, wonderful...
It is. It is. It really is, because it's such a painful subject, and there's a lot of laughs, and it has a very happy ending.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's going to be amazing. It's an amazing mm-hmm. movie. Yeah.
That's like that movie Folks with Tom Selleck. F-O-L-K-S with Don Ameche. It was his last film where he has the Alzheimer's, and it's a comedy, but through the whole thing, it just starts, and you just laugh all the way through it. But at the end of it, Tom Selleck's character ends up missing an eye, missing one testicle, walking with a cane for the rest of his life because his father keeps getting him into all of these things, you know? It's just one of those things where you have to find some humor in it because it's just so very, very tragic. You know? We're going to come back and just talk a little bit about more Dark Shadows before we let you go, but we're going to go to a commercial, and the last song is per Christopher Pennock request, and it's Neil Young, Old Man. So we'll be right back. This is GameCon Radio, and we are rocking your world tonight with Christopher Pennock.
Listening to Game Con Radio.
Yes?
Hi, I'm here for the New York Ghost Tour.
Sorry, we're closed. But you can come back next week.
Next week? Forget that. I'll just go check out another place.
Trust me, there's no place half as interesting as ours, dear.
That's so not true. What about the Shanley Hotel in Napanock?
Once you've been to one haunted hotel, you've been to them all.
Not like this place. The Shanley Hotel dates back to 1845, and since then it's been a hotspot for paranormal activity. Mysterious music, smells, whistling, doors opening, footsteps... Almost everything you can imagine has been experienced at that hotel.
It's open to the public?
Absolutely. Sal and Cindy, the owners of the hotel, welcome people for regular stays or investigations, and their rates are beyond reasonable. They even offer workshops and in-house psychics.
How did you learn about this place?
By visiting www.shanleyhotel.com. You can get history, investigation info, and much more.
Thanks, I think I will. Just don't tell any of our customers.
Your secret's safe with me. It's not like anyone can hear us.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. Again, I invite you to check out our schedule. We have a lot of great shows on all week long. It is just, it's a privilege to work with the people at GameCon Radio. It's a wonderful station, and I think once you get hooked on it, you're going to be hooked for good. One of your great friends, Mike Stoka.
Yeah, Mike Stoka.
Yeah. He was on there as the gypsy, right? Aristide?
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Yeah, he was probably my best friend on the show. He was probably the most psychedelic of all my friends on the show. He and I were heavily into the everything of the times. Mm-hmm. And I loved Mike, and I was with him during the last month of his life. He was in Hollywood, and he had kidney cancer. Mm-hmm. And I spent a lot of time over there with he and his girlfriend. Mm-hmm. As just before he died, and he's an amazing guy. He was also a very talented producer and director, which nobody knew. He produced Hurley Burley with Sean Penn. Mm-hmm. At a theater in L.A. and a lot of good stuff. He was a wild man, and I thought he was another incredible looking guy. If you really look at his face, whoa!
Very chiseled looks.
Amazing hair, big hair, the biggest hair of anybody on Dark Shadows.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. Mike was a great guy, and I miss him.
Yeah, Joan Bennett, another legendary actress, and the girls were on Laura and Catherine, and they said, somebody said, aren't you Joan Bennett? She said, I used to be. this is a woman that was at the top, and then a crazy husband kind of blew it, because back in the day, you didn't see all the garbage that you see now.
Now you see it instantly as it's happening.
They went to great strides to hide things. So when there was that little problem with her husband, suddenly she became undesirable.
What was the problem with her husband?
She was out with a male friend, and I don't exactly know the relationship. I'm trying to remember it, but anyway, her husband showed up with a gun and shot the guy. And
oh, that's right. That's right.
He didn't die, but that did it. She became
that did it.
A liability to the studio.
He was exiled to daytime TV.
Yeah, but that was daytime TV's notch. It was to their benefit, and honestly,
I know.
I think it kept her going to the end.
It sure did, yeah. Yeah, the last time I saw Joan, we had the Dark Shadows Festival in the World Trade Center Marriott. It was just before the first attack on the World Trade Center, where they had the bomb underneath, mm-hmm. And they tried to blow it up that way. I think five people got killed, but it was the first try. And anyway, we were there. George DiCenzo, who was also the producer with Dan Curtis, he was there, and he just passed on. And Joan could barely walk, and I remember I picked her up and walked up the stairs. I couldn't do that now with my hip replacement, mm-hmm. but walked right up on the stage carrying Joan Bennett, put her in the chair, and we carried on. Mm-hmm. And that was the last time I saw Joan. Mm-hmm. I remember thinking, I'm acting with Joan Bennett. I'm acting with all these incredible people. It was an amazing show.
The movie, it was House of Dark Shadows, right, that you were in? Which one was it that you were in?
I'm not sure. I get them both mixed up. I was in
Me
the
too.
Second one.
Yeah, you
were
in the
Selby second one. Selby and Kate Jackson. I was in that one. And I played
Laura
Gabriel
Parker.
Collins.
Right, you
and
were
in Angelique, she was in it. Yep. Frid was in the first one.
Yeah, he had a problem with
maybe somebody on the chat can tell us which is which.
Yeah, he had a problem with all the gore and everything for that, and I guess that's when he and Dan Curtis kind of got a little bit, tense.
Yeah, a little bit too much blood, too much gore.
Yeah, he said it was too violent, and he'd done all this work to turn. Actually, he was. He was the very first vampire you felt sorry for.
Right.
And he'd done all this work, and then in one swoop, he ended up becoming this bloodthirsty, conscienceless moron.
Right.
And it really upset him. How was it to work in it was the House of Dark Shadows?
That was great. That was fun. I think mine was the House of Dark Shadows.
Yeah.
That was great. I had just done another movie called Savages, which was at another mansion right up the Hudson. Uh-huh. And that was the first James Ivory Ismail Merchant movie, Ivory Merchant, who went on to do a lot of amazing Academy Award-winning movies. This is their first American movie. And it was with a lot of Dark Shadows people like Thayer David, Salome Jens was in it. It was amazing. Mm-hmm. And we were, once again, naked, and then we were in drag, and I was in drag in that one. It was good. And so it was like back-to-back movies in big mansions up the Hudson. It was pretty amazing, and then off to Hollywood, where everything stopped. But the House of Dark Shadows was great because it was a great character. It was Gabriel, and I got to unleash my insanity, my madness again, and Dan loved that.
Yeah.
He loved my insanity.
Yeah, for anybody that hasn't seen it, it's Quentin and his wife, and it's modern day, go back to this mansion, and a spirit possesses him and tries to continue a love affair from, you know, the years before, a couple of hundred years before. But as it turns out, the spirit of the woman's spirit involved is married to Christopher's, you know, character. And
Gabriel
brothers,
Collins.
Yeah, brothers may share a lot, but wives isn't one of them, you know. So it got gruesome, and Kate Jackson, she's another one that got a big star. A lot of actresses.
Kate Jackson, that was, her first big movie, and she went out to Hollywood right afterwards.
Yeah. You've done a lot of TV shows, too. Favorite TV show that you were on that you went, oh, wow, I'm so over the moon to be on this show. I love it.
Yeah, God, I did them all, Hotel, and I usually played really bad guys, psychos, monsters, sociopaths, rapists. I just got to play everything.
Yeah.
And Silk Stockings, I mean, I loved them all. Simon and Simon, I mean, every one of them.
You got
every one of them. I did them all in the 70s and 80s.
Cagney and Lacey, so you got to work with John again.
Yeah, Carlin was on that. Yeah,
Carlin?
Yeah.
It's an incredible piece of work that you've done, and you're still going strong, and I love that you're still working, you're still going out there, you're still doing it, and you're still very
vocal. Yeah, I just feel like it's just the beginning, you know?
Right.
It's just the beginning.
Yeah.
It's a whole new rebirth.
Yeah. If for those who are tuned in late or not, we want to remind you, your magazine is Fear and Loathing on Dark Shadows, and they can get it on your site, which is?
ChristopherPennock.com.
And the other Posey is going to the film festival.
Posey's going to film festivals. I've got another movie called Miracle Man that's coming out pretty soon. I'm finishing another film called The Four Horsemen, which is about the apocalypse.
Oh, wow.
I'm going to be filming that and finishing that in November, and that should be out probably in about 6 months. And there's another movie
you've got Lost on Purpose.
Oh, yeah, Lost on Purpose. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, Lost on Purpose, that's got the woman that got the Academy Award for The Help, Octavia Spencer.
Mm-hmm.
She co-stars with me on that. So that's going to be a biggie, Lost on Purpose.
Mm-hmm.
That should be coming out soon, too.
And
so
The Dresser.
I've got a lot of films in the can, and then The Dresser, the play I'm doing. So, yeah, everything's happening.
Okay, and again, The Dresser is in Los Angeles, Hollywood. Sorry, Hollywood.
Yeah, Hollywood, at the Actors Studio in the Long Pre and Suite, sir, and it opens October 19th until Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Then I will let everybody know if there's a continuation or a move to New York or something.
That'd be very cool. That'd be very cool. I'd love to see. Let me ask you how that works. Because, you know, like, you take jobs that are not in your home. You know, somebody asks you to do a play. You know, it's rough. Do they pay your way and rent and everything? Or you guys got to come up this money yourselves?
Usually for theater, unless it's a like really out of town, then they'll pay your way and they'll pay your hotel and everything.
Mm-hmm.
I'm commuting from my little mountain town in Idlewild. It's a 2-hour commute into L.A. And luckily, I just bought a Prius, so I'm getting good gas mileage. Cool. My previous car was a Land Rover. That was not good gas mileage.
Mm-hmm.
So I was going broke just on the gas alone, and then it started breaking down because it had 300,000 miles on it. Now I've got this brand new Prius, and I'm a very happy commuter. But it is rough, and actually it's rough on relationships and marriages, too. Because with the film business, suddenly, I mean, I met my wife in Kathmandu. We finally got together. We moved to Idlewild. I immediately get a movie in the Virgin Islands, and she has to stay here with the kids because I wasn't making it up to actually have them go down too, so that we had a 3-week separation. If I had a real film career going, we would always be separated, you know.
Right.
So it's very rough on the old relationships. Yeah.
Yeah, because when you add, you know, it's not bad. Even your wives were actresses. Your present wife, you met her; she was an actress. But once you put children into that, because you can't be pulling them in and out of schools, and I don't have any friends. We're always moving. You know, it can't work. So then somebody's got to do Kevin Bacon and his wife, the one from the Closer.
Kira Sedgwick, yeah.
Yeah. She said it. When I'm working, he's home with the kids. And when he's working, I'm home with the kids. He says,
yep.
And it's easier now. The kids are older. But when they were little, and you don't want to, derail your spouse's ability to find work because now they're 6 months because you're working on a project. So it can't be easy. It can't be easy. And of course, that's probably why most marriages in Hollywood don't work out well.
They don't work out. One reason why I moved to Idlewild, because it's a small town, about 2,000 people. It's sort of an artist colony.
Right.
And it's got great schools, but it is a little town. It's like our town.
Right.
Everybody knows each other. And you grow up with these people. And it was a wonderful place to raise kids. By the time they're ready for college, you know, they're ready to leave Ottawa and go to a city, which is what Tara's doing now. She's in San Francisco, and very happily. But what a place to raise kids. It was so healthy. It was so amazing. It was like, you know, Americana, a little town in the mountains.
Yeah.
It's great.
And as long as you keep them away from the TV with Los Angeles and San Francisco car chases, you got it made, right? I want to thank you so much for coming on, and you'll come back and visit us again, right?
I sure will.
Yeah, and I mean it. If this thing goes, like to New York, you got to let me know, man, so we can get together and I can see
you. We will get together and I'll buy you a drink at Sardi's.
That was so depressing. That whole, you know, it was a great experience, except that, you know, they had made all these reservations and all, and we were supposed to go upstairs and all, and then we ended up by the window, and we were like, what the hell? We made these reservations like forever ago, and because, you know, the restaurants are just first come, first serve. Even if you've got a reservation, you're first come, first serve, you know? It doesn't matter, so.
Well, God bless you,
and,
God bless you, and thank you. This was a lot of fun.
Thank you so much for coming on, and all you got to do is hang up, and I will let you know by posting the show when it's ready on the podcast and everything on your Facebook, okay?
Fantastic.
Okay,
Mo.
God bless.
Very good.
Love you.
Love you. Bye.
Night-night. Okay. All right, that was Christopher Pennock. We just had a little moment that I did something stupid. And we just had a wonderful hour and 45 minutes of fun. Christopher Pennock is an actor, director, artist. Again, you can find his magazine on his site, ChristopherPennock.com. Fear and Loathing on Dark Shadows. I'm definitely going to get these because it's supposed to be all about the things you didn't see and you don't hear about. And I'm sure there'll be more Dark Shadows typey festivals, and he will attend them when he can. But he also has a play he's working on that's going to be starting next month called The Dresser. And that's going to be in Los Angeles. It's going to start. So anybody that can get out there to see it, please do. That's going to be awesome. Now, next week, if you haven't gotten enough of your Dark Shadows fix, our guest is going to be Sharon Smith Lentz, and she played Sarah Collins, Barnabas Collins' young sister, the ghost, Sarah, on the show Dark Shadows. And Sharon is a pistol. I met her up in Tarrytown, and she is just funny, and she's full of energy, and this is really, I may need a seatbelt for that show for my kitchen table, I'm not sure. But she's going to be coming on next week. And then R.J. Jameson, who worked on a book called Barnabas and Company with Craig Hamrick. And what the book is literally an encyclopedia of the actors and actresses who were on the show, the air dates of the different episodes, and little trivia stuff that's in the back telling all kinds of little things that none of us knew about. And I think that you're really going to enjoy that show a lot. I met her also, and I think you're really going to enjoy that show. That's on the 25th. And then on the 9th, October 9th, we're going to have our favorite historian, Al Savalane, who's going to be coming back, and he's going to be talking to us about Rose Hill Cemetery and some other great stuff. Rose Hill Cemetery is going to be having October 20th tours. Rose Hill Cemetery in New Jersey, a second annual guided walking tour. And this cemetery is a great cemetery because the movie Jaws, the book Jaws, that was based on real 1916 shark attacks, which happened off of the Jersey coast. They even mention it in the book and movie. The shark attacks that happened in Mattawan, New Jersey, verbatim, the man tried to go and help the kids. His leg was taken off. They're all buried at Rose Hill. There's a lot of heroes and scoundrels buried. And Captain Morgan hid gold up on Rose Hill. So it's a very historic area. It's a fascinating cemetery. It's a beautiful old garden style cemetery. Or Captain Kidd. Captain Kidd used this cemetery to hide gold. So that's going to be coming up on the 9th. And then Noreen Dressler is going to come on the 16th. And Noreen is an author and a psychologist. And she's going to be talking about saying goodbye. And I'm working a case now which involves a grieving spouse. And saying goodbye is hard. Getting through that process when you finally can let go and say goodbye to a loved one. I'm hoping that Noreen is going to help us all learn better tools to deal with grief and moving on with our lives and that. So Noreen Dressler, she's a wonderful lady. She's going to be coming on. I just wanted to remind everybody, October 6th in Asbury Park is the zombie walk. And they have the Guinness World Book for zombie walks. So the whole town turns into zombies, and people walk all over the place as a zombie. It's really cool. Sleepy Hollow Cemetery. Check out their site, www.sleepyhollowcemetery.org. They're going to have a lot of nighttime tours from now through Halloween. And then in November, we're going to have the director of Sleepy Hollow Cemetery is going to come on and be a guest and talk about the cemetery. And there are very, very famous people buried there. It takes quite a bit to get buried in the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery. Allaire Historic Village in New Jersey, they're having a lot of things for Halloween. Smithville is going to have their zombie walk on October 28th, 2012. If you go to www.facebook.com/Smithville Zombie Walk, it's from 11 a.m. to 7. This is their second one. They're trying to make it really big. So everybody get your zombie makeup up and go on October 28th. Beverly Washburn, the guest, movie star that we had on a couple of weeks ago, she's going to be having a luncheon October 28th in Edison, New Jersey. Lyndhurst in Tarrytown, that's the estate that the two Dark Shadow movies were made on. They're going to have a whole bunch of fall stuff going on. So there's a lot going on. And if you have something going on in your area that you would like to share with people, come to www.asylumsgate.com. We have a members conventions and events thread forum. You can post it there as long as it's, you know, family orientated. I don't want, you know, that you're having strippers and, you know, stag night. Something, you know, that the whole family can attend. Please, if it's a haunted house, if it's a haunted tour, if it's not, if it's just a fall festival, a Christmas festival, a parade in your area, please don't think that coming to my site, you have to just post things that are macabre. We love anything that's a good time. So that's asylumsgate.com on the internet. And it's a free registration. You have to be approved, but that usually happens pretty fast. We approve everybody but spam and bots. Don't come there trying to sell, you know, sex toys or something, because I won't let you on the site. But that's what's going on for the next couple of weeks. We're going to have some great stuff going on the show. And our guest tonight was phenomenal, Christopher Pennock. A very funny, open guy, easy to talk to. Oh, yeah, the Lazaretto in October 6th and 7th. There's going to be Lazaretto Day. The Lazaretto is right outside Philadelphia, and they're going to have all kinds of things going on there. They're going to have a mystery going on. They're going to be dressed up like they were when the Lazaretto was open. Lazaretto was the first Ellis Island for the East Coast. It's where ships came in and people stayed in quarantine until they were passed and could come on the shore. And once it was closed, they built Ellis Island. So Lazaretto Day is the 6th and 7th of October. Lots of stuff going on, but I'm going to be posting it on the Asylum's Gate, so you can all check it up there. And once again, I want to thank everybody for listening to the show. I can't thank our listeners enough. Send our links around. This is going to be on YouTube and Podomatic. So there'll be two places you can listen to. It'll stay permanently on YouTube. Our sympathies go to people who lost family and loved ones who were victims of the attacks on 9/11 and died because they helped on 9/11. A lot of people that were helping, dig through the rubble have gotten sick and died from diseases related to asbestos and everything else. Our sympathies go with them, but please, let's move on. Let's remember that these people are heroes, and we don't want to dwell that they were victims. They were all heroes. And as I said, it was an attack on humanity. It wasn't just an attack on Americans. There were people from all walks of life, all nations, all faiths killed that day. And I think that that's the big thing we have to remember. We're all humans. We're all in this together. And the sooner we get that through our heads and start working together, the faster things are going to get better on this earth. And with that, I'm going to say thank you, good night, and God bless you all. I love you. Visiting me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair is broadcast live on Tuesday evenings at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Mountain, 7 p.m. Pacific, and in the UK, 3 a.m. Wednesday mornings on www.gameconradio.com. You can listen to our recent recordings on Podomatic/Mo Banshee. You can contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for listening. God bless you and yours, and have a very cool day.